piggyback? Now let me see, if my calculations are correct, the date ought to be... Excuse me, could someone out there tell me what date this is?
February 4th, 1986.
Oh, thank you, gosh, it is. And someone else, can you tell me what time it is? I mean exactly.
7:44 p.m.
Woo! I'm here in time for the opening. Now let me see. Byron Kennard ought to come through these curtains right about now.
Good evening and welcome to the Public Interest Follies.
I'm about to witness an historic event.
Who are you? What are you doing on the stage?
Me? Well, I'm just a guy from the future.
From the future?
Yeah, the year 2016, to be precise.
That's impossible.
Well, not in my time. See, we can time travel.
Oh, come on.
No, really. Well, my name is Artie, and I'm a student at Planetary University, class of 2016, and I'm working on my senior thesis, which is on political satire.
Well, look, buddy, we got a show to do.
Well, that's why I'm here, to see it. It changed history, you know.
Changed history? What do you mean, changed history?
Well, it's all here in this book. The script, the program, the consequences that followed, everything.
Let me see this. The influence of political satire on the liberal resurgence of the late 20th century. By Professor Louise P. Grumbacher, published in the year 2007. Uh-huh. My God, is the Public Interest Follies mentioned in that book?
Mentioned? Don't be silly. That's all the book's about.
Was our show, this show, a hit?
Oh, it was a big success, but more than that, it got the liberals all enthusiastic and excited again. And then they started to win elections. Took the White House back.
Cut the crap. How big a hit?
Big enough to go to Broadway. Big enough to go to Broadway.
Broadway? Rear? Broadway?
Oh, sure, and you guys run for years.
Longer than Chorus Line?
Not as long as that.
Damn.
But you guys do go down in history. According to Professor Grumbacher, you guys kick off the glorious liberal revolution in 1992, and that's when all the problems get solved. You guys secure world peace, an end to hunger, you guys have equal rights for all, an end to disease.
I wonder what theater we're playing on the Broadway. Oh, I hope it's the Palace. But is the Palace big enough?
And you guys do it all democratically.
Maybe there's a cable deal in the works.
Of course, we still have some problems.
You bet the second act hasn't begun to come together.
There's Reagan's deficit. We're still struggling to pay that off. The costs are phenomenal.
Rents are so high in New York. But I've been making all that money.
But the biggest dilemma, at least for me anyway, is that since you guys solved all the problems, there's nothing left to make fun of. And satire is my favorite thing. I want to be a satirist. But where do I find targets?
I knew I should have copyrighted my material.
Boy, Mr. Kennard, I sure do envy your time, and that's why I came back to 1986, because you have so much to satirize.
Maybe there's still time. Hey, kid, listen, could you take over for me and produce the skits and stuff?
Sure, on everything that happened. It's here in the professor's book.
Great, I've got to run. I got to call my agent.
But Mr. Kennard! That's funny. According to Professor Grumbacher's analysis, he doesn't even have an agent. And when this show is taken to Broadway, his part is played by Richard Gere. Oh, well, I'm happy. Here I am, back where I've always wanted to go. Oh, what a year to make fun of. And satire's my favorite art. There's nothing you can't make a pun of, and the joke's a deadly dart. But a year filled with absurdity is the year I want to see. All the world was cheering Rocky Rambo flicks just to see Sylvester with the Bolsheviks. I wanna go back to 1986. Censors claimed rock lyrics were promoting sex, so the Live Aid record got the rating X. I wanna go back to 1986. are books by Miss MacLean, the star who roams the astral plane. Her latest book discloses her lives as Christ and Moses. And do you believe it? How about George Bush asking Jerry Falwell, won't you kiss my tush? I want to go back to 1986. Maggie Thatcher's making Britain great. Well, at least one woman can discuss pro weight. I want to go back to 1986. Have you heard the joke told by the president? Not a soul could tell you what the punchline meant. I want to go back to 1986. If your hair needs a trim or two, just ask Jack Kemp what to do. His hair's so very blow-dried, but heavy on supply side. There was Halley's Comet and a Star Wars cell. When it comes again, they'll blow it straight to hell. I want to go back to 1986.
Jane Fonda has made over $100 million from her exercise empire, and all her profits support left-wing causes. Not to be outdone, a noted conservative tonight premieres her exercise video. Let's watch her firm up the sagging pound and flex her muscles with unruly cabinet ministers as we bring you the Maggie Thatcher Workout Tape.
Reach! your ass. Goodbye.
Tell you that in the year 2007 it was proven that exercise is hazardous to your health. It says here in Dr. Grumbacher's analysis that the resultant demise of the Nautilus, leotard, and heavy hands industries wreaked havoc on the U.S. economy for years. Do any of you happen to have an old pair of Nikes or Pumas or something I could take back to my time and show my friends? It'd be a great artifact.
And now, a public service announcement from the American Medical Association to guide you in making those health care decisions which could mean life or death.
Hi, my name is Jane Doe. I have an appointment with the doctor at 10:30.
Jane Doe, go up the form while I run a computer check.
Oh, I don't think that my name's gonna be in there. This is my first visit with Dr. Demigod.
Oh, honey, it's not your health records we're looking for. We could care less about your medical history. It's an entirely different kind of history we want to know about. Jane Doe. Oh my. Oh, there you are. The doctor won't see you.
What do you mean he won't see me? I've been waiting weeks for this appointment.
He won't see you. You're a bad risk.
Oh, it's my credit record, isn't it? There was this teeny weeny bill I forgot to pay, but I have cash. Loads of cash.
Doesn't matter how much cash you brought, because Dr. Demigod's services are not available to people like you.
People like me? Oh, but I'm a great patient. I come to all my appointments on time, even though the doctor is usually 2.5 hours late. I come to my follow-up visits, even though they're unnecessary and ridiculously expensive. I take all my medication on time, and I always try to have a full bladder so your doctor can take a urine specimen. Oh, what is going on here?
All right, you see this little screen? This little screen warns us about people like you, Ms. Doe. You, according to Physicians Alert, have a litigious nature.
How would you know? The doctor hasn't even examined me yet.
Just how many physicians have you sued?
Oh, well, just one. But you would have sued him too. I went to the doctor, told him I had a stomach ache. He sent me home, told me it was gas. And the next thing you know, my appendix ruptured.
And you had to slap him with a malpractice suit. Well, you won't be able to pull that little number on Dr. Demigod, because he wouldn't touch you with a 10-foot pole.
But please, I'm really sick. I need to see a doctor.
No self-respecting doctor is ever going to take a look at you again. I guess your only option is to try a university teaching hospital. I understand that George Washington is looking for patients for their first-year medical students to practice on.
Don't let this happen to you. Think twice before you call your lawyer and parlay that little ailment into big bucks. Remember, if you get sick, don't sue. And if you do sue, don't ever get sick again. Remember, we need you more than we need you.
I can't believe you all used to sue your doctors.
In my time, if the patient doesn't respond well to treatment, the doctor sues the patient.
Uh-oh. My life belt is telling me something. I am starving. Is there any place nearby where I can get like a sandwich or a cup of coffee?
Rio.
A what?
Rio.
Where is that?
1752.
Where is that?
1752.
But I told Byron that I was going to go ahead and take over the show for him. I don't know if I have... Well, I guess I better go.
17th and Q, huh? Okay, tell him I'll be right back, okay?
Hey there! Want you all to meet the new waitress I hired today. Gal, this here is Margaret Heckler. Now, Margaret, we get some pretty rough customers in here at the Trio. And it's up to you gals to see as to if the place don't get busted up or nothing. Now, this lady over here, Jean Kirkpatrick, well, Jean claims to be some kind of expert on security matters. Jean, honey, why don't you show Margaret your stuff?
You got a problem.
Oh, I ain't got no problem, at least not with you, Jean. Now another problem is them pain in the ass health inspectors. See that lady over there? That's Ann Burford. Now Ann can tell you how to get those guys off her backs.
You tell the congressman, I mean the inspector, that while the management has nothing to hide, we do not, as a matter of principle, allow anyone to see the restaurant's health certificate. Furthermore, our lawyer has advised us that it is our privilege to say a word if anybody sees an ulcer.
Right. Now, Margaret, you try one on your own. Our policy is pay when served. Now, what would you do if some jerk comes up short?
Well, sir, I'd ask him if he had any food stamps.
What? Are you nuts? I ain't running no soup kitchen here. Maybe you two can straighten her out.
We were wondering when you'd get here.
What hell of a reunion, huh?
Well, how did we all end up here?
Well, what's just about the only thing we have in common?
Well, we all work here at the Trio.
Other than that, we're all women. And
we all got the shaft.
Yeah, and if Ronnie stuck by that racketeer Donovan and that wife beater Fetters till a bitter end, I just did everything Meese told me to. Now I work in this dive and that asshole is Attorney General.
Nothing. I paid my dues at the UN, and when it came time for a promotion, the word was, you've come a long way, and that's far enough.
I see what you mean. Where did Don Regan get off telling me I was a lousy manager? After all, it was his guys who sent the president to Bitburg.
Say, just where did you three work before?
Hard for running. Ronnie, we loved you. You were our guy. But you hung us out to dry. Listen, asshole, somebody's gonna cry. We worked hard for Ronnie. So hard for Ronnie. We worked hard for Ronnie, but he did not treat us right. Yeah, yeah, we worked hard for Ronnie. So because she would not be there, sir. Me said, you can trust me, and then he let her take the rap. They're all power hungry, men, they love that gender gap. So hard for Ronnie. We worked hard for Ronnie, but he did not treat us right. Yeah, yeah, yeah. We worked hard for Ronnie. Whoa.
Political constructs, you know, as they really happen throughout history. You know, just the other day I was talking to one of my friends about these political constructs, and I was saying, we were up ordering Venus at the time, and we had...
Hey! You!
Yeah? Yes.
So, you call yourself the time traveler?
Yeah!
Well, that's false advertising, because I'm the time traveler.
You are? Who are you?
Who am I? Ken! I wrote the book on time travel.
Now I know who you are. You're Warren Beatty's sister. Gosh, I just love Reds.
Kid, I am Shirley MacLaine. Academy Award-winning actress and author of several best-selling books, including my latest, Off the Deep End. They're all about my soul's travels throughout history, occupying the bodies of a variety of incredibly interesting and important people.
Yeah, but what are you doing here?
Well, you know, I was born here in Washington, and I've got kind of sentimental memories about the place. Although, when you've had as many childhoods as I've had, it tends to get a little blurry.
Gee, you know, that's really amazing.
Yeah, isn't it? But I'll tell you something else. I have another purpose for being here tonight, and that's all of you out in the audience, because you think you're so political, right? Huh? Okay. Well, I've been political. I've been there. I've seen it all. Anti-war, Vietnam, the women's movement, blah, 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 blah. The whole thing. And I can tell you, I have found that there is something larger and more important that I've had to come to know and understand.
Wow. That's really beautiful. You mean the spirit world, right?
No, I mean me. Shirley!
Oh.
Oh, kid, I have so many things I could tell you about me. All the incredible people I've met and been.
Well, who is the most important person that you've met, besides yourself, I mean? You know, who is your mentor? Who is your guru?
Oh, kid. Don't you ever ask me who my guru is. Unless you've got an hour, or two, or three. Because I need time to tell you who my guru is. And all the things my guru means to me. Kid, don't you know a song cue when you hear one? My kind of guy. Mohandas is. My kind of guy, Mohandas is. My kind of guru too. A Hindu. Ha!
But in her next life, her soul transmigrates into a warthog at the National Zoo. Oh, well, you know, this next sketch should be really interesting. According to Professor Grumbacher's analysis, it says here that it's going to show us the democratic processes in public interest organizations as they really worked. Now, Professor Grumbacher adds that, after all, most government and corporate decision-making is now based on the model of the Follies Board. At least that's what Dr. Grumbacher says.
Fellow board members, your attention, please. The coalition meeting will now come to order. We will begin by reciting the oath.
I pledge allegiance to the cause and to the selflessness for which it stands, all for good and good for all.
Will the board members briefly identify themselves and the organizations they represent?
Madam Chairperson, my name is Beverly Whitlow, and I'm president of the Daughters of the Sexual Revolution. Our organization consists exclusively of women who can trace their ancestry to socially prominent feminists of the past, such as Eleanor Roosevelt, Susan B. Anthony, and Attila the Hun.
Attila the Hun? I didn't know Attila the Hun was a feminist.
That's because you've only read history books written by men. Furthermore, just because she was assertive doesn't mean she was a barbarian.
Thank you. Next.
Look. I'm Donald Oppenheimer, and I'm out to save the world, and I don't have a lot of time, okay? Okay? I'm executive director of the Union of Disturbed Scientists. And all we're saying is, give peace a chance, goddammit! And give me the credit.
Next!
Buddha, why have you brought me here tonight? Is this part of your great plan for me?
Name an organization, please.
Oh, my name is Tim, Your Holiness, and I'm the editor of the New Age Reader's Digest, a spiritual journal that compresses the wisdom of the universe into small, digestible little bits. We're devoted to nonviolence.
Oh, give me a break.
Cooperation and sharing.
Bullshit.
And universal love.
Next.
Your Honor, my name is John Hay Diddle. I'm with the Endangered Species Defense Council. We litigate to protect threatened animals.
All of the animals?
No, we focus on those that are particularly well-bred. Yeah, you know, black Angus cattle, Afghan hounds, race horses. Top draw, strictly top draw.
Thank you. The floor is now open to new business.
Madam Chairperson! This organization was established to do good. And so I've been thinking about new ways to do more good.
I'll be praised.
Oh, tell me about it. Yeah.
And I think the way to do it is to begin by establishing priorities.
Second.
So I'd like to move that we rank the advancement of women.
Second.
First.
Objection, Your Honor.
Second.
An objection doesn't need a second.
Oh, well, I need a second to meditate.
Look, I can live with the motion, even though it misses the goddamn point, which is the survival of the human race. But we have to make one change in it.
Do you have an amendment?
I do. I move that we strike women and substitute the word peace.
You sexist pig!
You wanna not cross the bench, the legal rights of thoroughbreds are at stake, yeah?
I move that we substitute the word love for the word women. That way we can embrace both peace and women.
Oh, love my ass.
Look, I want the word peace in there, and I'm willing to fight for it.
Point of personal privilege.
Isn't that just like a man always invoking privilege to sexist pigs?
You know, love can be interpreted to include pigs, too.
Yes, but I don't want men included in my motion.
The disturbed scientists have the capability of blowing up this whole coalition.
If threatened animals are left out of this motion, my organization will bring a class action suit. I mean an upper class action suit.
What bullshit!
Beverly, what effort do you have against bulls? Why, some of them are absolutely fabulous for breeding.
I'm about to explode!
Brothers and sisters, please try to remember the nonviolent example of Dr. Albert Schweitzer, to whom I have often been compared.
Oh, really? Schweitzer is a tough pig.
But let's try to remember that the purpose of our organization is selflessness. So why don't we try to be more like me?
You! Who the hell would want to be like you?
Well, at least he's not rude to women.
Shut up, you bitch!
Bitch! You shut up!
Order! Order! We will now vote on the motion as amended. Be it resolved that the priority of this organization shall be the advancement of women, peace, love, and thoroughbred animals. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say me.
Me.
The egos have it.
Gee whiz, you know, consensus decision making was nothing like that in my Management 101 class. Maybe that's what Professor Grumbacher meant when she said there's always a difference between theory and practice. Oh, wait a minute, I'm sorry, I forgot about this. There's a special announcement that was just handed to me backstage. The Haitian press announced today that the U.S. government had collapsed. The ex-patriot celebrate, and began making reservations for flights back to LaGuardia. Now, these reports were contradicted when President Reagan interrupted his afternoon nap and appeared on American television saying, "My tail is as firm as a monkey." Now no one is quite sure what that meant. Only Nancy seemed to understand his comments. But she vehemently denied that this was true. Thank you very much.
The pundits have begun to speculate about the 1988 presidential election. Will it be George Bush or Bob Dole, Gary Hart or Mario Cuomo? But what the pundits don't realize is that the days of politician presidents are over. In fact, there's only one man who can convey the Republican message as clearly as Ronald Reagan can. Tonight, in his first live press conference, we present to you the 1988 Republican presidential nominee, Sylvester Stallone.
Any of you pointy-headed liberals got any questions for me?
Yes, Mr. Sloan.
Yo.
Yes, Prime Minister Thatcher rejected U.S. policy in Central America. You called her, and I quote, "that dumb broad who can't keep her own mix of ragheads in line." Could you comment on that, please?
Hey, you know, I mean, that was one of them there, what do you call it, so presidential indiscretions, you know? I mean, imprecisions, you know? Old man Reagan told me that was all right. Anyway, I was just speaking dramatically. What I meant to say was that the United States has complete confidence in Her Majesty's government's treatment of Indian and Irish citizens. Yeah. Now, you got anything else to ask me, jerk off?
Mr. Rambo, can you tell us a little bit about your foreign policy proposals and your proposals for world peace?
Yeah, well, you know, I mean, I'm definitely for that world peace stuff. I mean, you know, as long as our peace is bigger than the Russians' peace. Well, basically, all we gotta do is keep doing what we've been doing, you know? I mean, if I can make Rocky IV, then why not Grenada II, right?
Mr. Balboa, would you consider naming a black or Hispanic as vice president?
Yeah, sure. I mean, back in Philly, a lot of minorities I knew went for vice. Hey, anyway, that's no problem because the Republican Party's always had a lot of minority support. That's no problem. I mean, down in Miami, for instance, we got the Banana Republicans, right?
Yeah, yes, but Mr. Balboa, what do you propose to do about black unemployment?
Now, there you go again. There's plenty of jobs for colored guys. All you got to do is look in a newspaper. Here, my handler here's got one right now. Here we go. Yeah, there we go. Wanted. 300-pound bald man with 40-inch biceps to play drug dealer. White men need not apply.
Mr. Rambo, the International Monetary Fund has noted that the GNP of developing nations isn't an inverse acceleration growth ratio to the monetary stimulus of the M1 and M2 with the Fed. Do you have any comment on that?
Yeah, I got a comment. Fuck you.
Mr. Rocky, what do you think about the Democratic presidential candidate?
Hey, you know, I mean, that Democratic candidate's turkey, you know, I mean, what can I say? Who is this dude anyway, Bruce Springsteen? I mean, let's face it, the man is all substance and no style, you know what I mean? Yeah, and furthermore, I think that the American people expect a little more experience from their presidential candidates than a couple of videos.
Mr. Rambo, how would you define your political philosophy?
Yeah, well, you know, I think of myself as a physical conservative, you know?
Are you confident of victory in November?
Am I confident? Hey, I am confident. You mean I'm ready. I tell you, I am so confident that I already had my handler here measure the Oval Office for the linoleum, you know?
Thank you, Mr. President, and a parrot.
Tell you who wins the presidential election in 1988, but you know, I just can't because it would change history. What can I tell you? Oh, yeah, your long distance service doesn't get straightened out until the year 2000, and that's not until after a group of irate customers kidnap Cliff Robertson and Joan Rivers for 3 weeks and they make them do each other's commercials. Now, let's see. Oh. Huh, the next skit is called The Free Market Approach. Now, there's one thing that I'm really confused about. If your enterprise is free, why does everything cost so much? I guess I better go back to Dr. Grumbacher's book. She must explain it somewhere.
We now take you to the boardroom of the Gyno Ortho Corporation.
Oh, my God! Mr. Ortho Novo! The worst thing just happened!
Yes, what is it?
Congress! Congress just outlawed birth control! What are we gonna do?
Oh, that. Don't worry about it. Adaptability is the name of the game.
Don't worry. Don't worry, but contraceptives are our business.
Really? I've been prepared for that for some time. Take a look at my alternative plan.
But this'll never work!
Will it? Win a bet? Get me an appointment with the President of the USA, and on the double. Mr. President, I'm honored. It's been a long time.
Oh, really?
I haven't seen you since the Gyno Ortho Pack dinner raised $1 million for your re-election.
Well, didn't you get our thank you note?
Yes, fine. Mr. President, as you know, we're believers in the free market approach.
Right.
Whatever can be sold, we'll try to sell it. We've been riding high on this liberal wave of birth control and family planning for some time.
Those days are over. Well, thank goodness for that.
Yeah, times are changing and we're changing with it, sir. Mr. President, we know you're concerned about our national security, but you still don't have the ultimate assurance where we can fend off a Soviet attack.
Well, we are working on it, you know. Why? Do you have a plan?
Private industry always has a plan. You want a nuclear shield? We'll give you a nuclear shield. And one that's a lot cheaper than SDI. A giant diaphragm. Imagine it, sir, an impenetrable diaphragm that encircles the United States and all of our allied nations.
But will it work?
Will it work? Plastic clam has been protecting women on Earth for decades against a most dangerous weapon. Feel this material.
Thing is really strong.
And for extra protection, we'll throw in giant condoms that our CIA agents can slip over Soviet warheads.
What a bargain, sir! Well, I don't know how the Pope will like that idea, but I'll go for it. Give me a dozen of those things. On second thought, Make it 24. Why didn't Casper think of this years ago? You know, I just can't wait to show Nancy this little thing.
Good night, Mr. President. I don't believe he bought it.
Just leave it to the free market approach.
But high atop Mount Olympus, the president's Star Wars initiative has the gods up in arms.
Nuclear warheads. Who do these mortals think they are anyway?
Minerva, darling, what on earth are you mumbling about?
The end of the world. Maybe the solar system.
What?
It's the stupid mortals. They're gonna blow it all away.
Now see here, young lady. Aren't you the goddess of war? How could you let this happen?
Oh, Dad, I've been under a lot of pressure these last 4,000 years. First, I'm the goddess of reason. Then, I'm the goddess of war. One day it's Plato, the next it's Casper Weinberger.
Jupiter, can't we get Mars and the Furies to shoulder more of the burden?
Oh, Mom. Oh, Mars does his gallivant on Earth, and all those Furies do his pillage. Besides, it was one lousy roll in the hay that got us in this mess.
You've been down to Earth with a mortal.
Great soul.
When?
1905. In Zurich. On a trolley.
I don't understand, Minerva. First, how did you do it on a trolley? And secondly, what does this have to do with the end of the world?
Now let me finish.
Oh, this is easy. Albert, darling. Things just haven't been the same since. When I was just a little goddess, I toppled Troy with just one horse. And though I know I sound immodest, there once was joy in deadly force. War was fun, war was great. Gods and mortals happy to engage in honest trade. Gordian knots, Roman plots, and all agreed to decorate the hero's splendid grave.
War was fun, war was great. Gods and mortals happy to engage in honest trade. Gordian knots, Roman plots. And all agreed to decorate the hero's splendid grave.
She gave the Mongol hordes their ponies. She butchered Turks and the Crusade. She had the popes and kings as cronies. Why, she gave Joan of Arc her aid. But it's plain, things don't change. Jolly knights in shining armor are by now passé. Satellites, terminals and warheads, I would turn them on today.
But it's plain, things do change. Jolly knights in shining armor are by now passé. Satellites, megabytes, terminals and warheads, I would turn them on today.
I put myself right out of business. The day I whispered MC squared, we'll have to move from Mount Olympus. For now they're taking stellar shields are gonna fight here. Laser beams, stellar shields, missiles whirring into heaven to the stratosphere.
Mom and Dad, things look bad. With laser beams and stellar shields, they're gonna fight it here. I hear it's laser beams, stellar shields, missiles whirring into heaven through the stratosphere.
Minerva, Are you saying we have no place to go?
That's about the size of it.
Howdy, howdy, howdy. Girls, I'd like to meet my mom, my dad, and my lovely sister Minerva.
Pleased to meet you.
Mars, your sister tells us we will have to move from Mount Olympus because the humans want to blow it all up, and the skies aren't safe.
Well, I may be the god of war, but I've been spending so much time down on Earth that I'm beginning to feel like one of them. And I'm certainly not ready to give it all up yet. After all, if they bomb, we'll miss the frog, miss the hop and soda pop, miss the derby, julep punches, and the bets we made on hunches. If they bomb, we'll miss the show, circus and the rodeo, miss Spoleto, Rigoletto. Won't get to read the libretto. I'll miss Shakespeare.
I will miss Italian nights.
Special making Lear.
I will miss Miami Vice.
I'll miss kissing.
I'll miss carnal intercourse.
I'll miss missing.
I'll miss getting a divorce.
Divorce, 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 divorce.
No!
We don't want to bomb the planet. We are happy on it, and we want to keep it holy, party. No, we don't want to bomb the planet. We are happy on it, and we want to keep it home. No,
we don't want to bomb the planet. We are happy on it, and we want to keep it holy, party. No,
we don't want to bomb the planet. We are happy on it, and we want to keep it home.
I know there's life after death, but honey, don't you hold your breath. As I think the poet said, the grave is private, but we're private. No phones ringing, no folks sing, ain't no parties underground.
Underground, underground!
I don't like it underground!
Miss my mother and my brother, my dozens of first cousins, not to mention eight bad pension. I say I want to stay here.
No! We don't want to bomb the planet. We are happy on it, and we want to keep it whole and party. No! We don't want to bomb the planet. We are happy on it, and we want to keep it whole. No! We don't want to bomb the planet. We are happy on it, and we want to keep it whole and party. No! We don't want to bomb the planet. We are happy on it, and we're happy on it, and we want to keep it whole. We're happy on it, and we want to keep it whole. No, no.
Reflect new and changing social values. No racist, ethnic, ageist, sexist jokes, that sort of thing.
So, as you can see, it's a tough thing to pull off, but, you know, I have a great idea. Why don't we just show him how we do it?
Let's call some auditions.
Hey, it's a great idea. Listen, I'll just go over here and I'll sit down and take some notes.
Great. Okay, who's going first?
Some kind of song parodies, I think.
Song parodies?
Hi.
Hi.
It's really, really great to meet you. I'm Alfred. I work for the Clean Air, Land, Water, and Baby Seals Action Project. And I wrote this fabulous song while I was out canvassing last week. My girlfriend says it's the funniest song she's ever heard. But it's political. It's highly political.
Great. Well, we'd love to hear it.
Okay. Oh, give me... Wait. Oh, give me a home where the buffalo roam and the deer and the antelope play. Here comes the good part. And seldom is heard a discouraging word, and the skies are polluted all day. Home, home on the range, where the deer and the antelope play. And seldom is heard a discouraging word, and the oil companies ain't gonna fuck with us no way. Did you get it?
Get it, Kathy?
It's about ecology.
Yeah.
Alfred, I'll tell you, don't call us, we'll call you.
Well, you better make up your mind fast, because Hexagon is definitely interested.
Great, well, they can have him. Excuse me, what is going on here?
This is Public Interest Follies.
Well, yeah, but who are you?
Well, we're from the White House. Maureen Reagan is here.
Maureen?
She wants to try out for your show.
Maureen Reagan, you've got to be kidding.
No way, Bub. She read your ad in the city paper.
Hello! I didn't see your last show, but I'm dying to break into show business. And I've got some great original material here that will knock you dead. I mean, can we talk? I just love visiting Dad in Washington because the people here make me feel great. In California, everybody is tan, thin, and gorgeous. In Washington, the people are pale, ugly, and fat. You know, I saw Ted Kennedy the other day. Has he gotten fat?
How fat is he?
I'm glad you asked me that question. Mosquitoes see him and shout, "Who fat?" When he holds ass, when that guy holds ass, he has to make two trips. Now, Chuck Frog is good looking enough to be president, you know, but he hasn't got a prayer with that ugly wife of his, Lindbergh. Is she ugly? Am I right?
Right.
A dog in the 60s, and today she is still Alpo City. And stupid, I heard she has to study for a pap test. Now, speaking of stupid Democrats, I cannot believe that Gary Hart is running for president again. Remember him? He's the guy last time. He didn't know his name. He didn't know his age. I went in a department store with him. He saw a sign that said, "Wet floor," and he did. Great stuff, huh?
Ms. Reagan, your material isn't exactly appropriate for us. You see, we're all liberal.
Well, Byron, we're not so much liberal as we're left-wing, really.
We are too liberal.
Go speak for yourself, you bourgeois reactionary. Oh, bro, what? You stupid Stone Age bow wow. I bet you slept your way to the top with a bag on your head, and you let a chick tell them?
Who's next?
Oh, I don't know. It's some professional comedian.
Professional?
Ha ha ha!
Nah, we no change of color.
No, that's chameleon.
That's my favorite flower.
No, that's camellia.
Camellia yourself,
no,
honey.
No.
Get on with the audition, please.
And now a day at Grace's. Enter the ice cream vendor.
Ice cream. Get your tootsy fruity ice cream right here. Hey, you, hey, come here. Hey, you want something hot?
Nah, don't like hot ice cream.
I just didn't sell ice cream. That's a fake. I'm full of police. I sell a tips on the horse.
Pardon me, sir, you in the gray hat there. Are you an Italian?
Nah, I just will talk it this away.
Excuse me, but as an American of Italian descent, I find this characterization deplorable. Byron, this is the kind of stereotype we simply cannot reinforce. I mean, in addition, these people are shown to be engaged in illegal activities.
Well, let's try this.
Sir, I've never been so insulted in all my life.
Well, it's early.
But you do care for me just a little.
Yes, and you'll never know how little.
Wait, am I to understand that an older woman is to be the butt of your jokes?
Well, I'd fight for this lady's honor, which is more than she'd ever do.
Oh, Byron!
This is ageist and sexist and completely unacceptable.
Wait a minute! You with the hat there? You mean you can't speak? Oh, Byron!
You mean this man who is handicapped? I mean physically challenged. Is to be the object of abuse on the stage?
Oh,
no way.
I have seen enough. This material is disgusting.
Well, in that case, could you lend us $50 until payday?
$50?
Yeah, don't worry, I'll get your money. I'll give you my personal note for 90 days. After 90 days, you can keep the note.
Ouch! You out of here! I'm serious!
Never make it in show business.
You know, in the movie, the DuPont Circle story, that's the movie about the Follies. But then again, I guess you haven't seen it yet. It wins Best Picture in 1998. Well, you know, that scene you just saw was even better here than it was in the movie, but Meryl Streep sure was great as Maureen Reagan's part.
Amigos! Welcome to the first UOSO show for U.S. Mercenary Forces! Of course, technically you are not U.S. troops, but you might as well be. And now, let's give a big jungle welcome to tonight's MC, the personal envoy of Ron and Nancy, Mr. Frank Mercenatra!
Really great to be here, really, really great. You know, it's also kind of nice being where the Organized Crime Commission can't get to me. You know, it's a privilege to be here with you folks. It's a privilege to be with you courageous people who are willing to put down other people's lives for your noble cause. And speaking of freedom fighters, I am pleased to announce that we've just been told by our CIA humanitarian liaison officer that this tour, which started in Grenada, has been extended, and in 2 weeks we'll be playing in Angola. Well, I'd like to introduce the real stars of tonight's show. Those dedicated and ideologically correct daughters of the conservative revolution. Let's hear a big hand for the Mersonettes. A one, two, one, two, three, four.
He works from early dawn until it's late at night, killing little kids and even nuns and brides. He's been trained by Uncle Sam to keep the communists out, just like in South Vietnam. And the Pentagon jumps when he plays Reveille. He's the freedom fighting contra boys and down from D.C. He sneaks across the border at least twice a day, taking his directions from the CIA, fully armed with our supplies. How does he get his grenades?
Humanitarian aid.
And the senators jump when he shouts poverty. He's the freedom fighting contra boys and down from D.C. He is some freedom fighting contra boys and down from D.C. He always says he's only an advisor and he'll never pull a trigger in the field. But if he's caught, he'll never show some form of ID, as he's the nameless faceless contra boys and down from D.C. A rat.
A tat.
A rat tat.
M16 in his hand.
He's got a Rambo rhythm,
teaching about covert assassinations. And the cabinet smiles when he kills steadily. He's the freedom fighting contra boy sent down from D.C.
Wars in South America. He landed in Grenada and was in Chile.
He's trained his whole life long to push the peasantry down and keep dictatorship strong. He's loved by fascists and by the petite bourgeoisie, cause he's the freedom fighting contra boy sent down from D.C. And the president smiles when he kills steadily, cause he's the
freedom fighting
contra boy.
Freedom fighting
contra boy. The freedom fighting contra boy sent down from D.C.
You all realize what a big night this is for me. There's so much for me to see and do while I'm here in Washington. You know, I hope I get a chance to go over to see the DuPont Circle building. I hear this is the weekend that they're evicting all the tenants. I also understand they're changing the name of it to this weekend to the Oliver T. Carr building on Oliver T. Carr Circle. You know, of course, you know, I've seen the Public Interest Monument at DuPont Mall, but you know, I'd love to have gone back to see the building when all the big public interest groups were really still there. You know, maybe even I could have caught a glimpse of Ralph Nader, but knowing him, he'd never leave work this early. Jeez.
The following is a message from the National Endowment for the Arts.
I'm J. Barter Crown, the director of the British National Gallery, and a close personal friend of the royal family, with the exception, of course, of Princess Margaret. I've come here tonight to talk about our plans for a new exhibit, The Treasure Houses of the USA. Or rather, what would have been our new exhibit if we hadn't run into a few snags. You see, your National Gallery has been doing so well with our treasure houses that we thought we should reciprocate and, well, jump on the gravy train, so to speak. I mean, why shouldn't we get in on some of that corporate money that's just flying around here? And so anyway, I've come here to find out exactly how we do that. I mean, what are they doing with all of that money? They're not sending it to Africa, or housing the needy, or like closing down the slums. I mean, honestly, I was sent here to look at the great family collections that were gathered by these monies that were put together for the public good. Fat bloody chance. You see, in Britain, at least the nobility had the notion of enriching the country as they enriched themselves. In the past 6 months since I've been here, I've seen the Annenberg's collection, or the Annenberg's golf course at Rancho Mirage, Cornelia Guest's condo in Palm Beach, Malcolm Forbes' collection of toy soldiers and hot air balloons, and Nelson Hunt's warehouse of silver bullion. I mean, how the bleeding H am I going to put together a catalog of freaking silver bullion? Why did all these old farts go to so much trouble to gather all of this money if all they were going to do is frivol it away? I was about to pack it all up and bugger off when I realized where these great collections actually were. They're in places like Brooklyn and Boise, Wichita and Walla Walla. The average American Jane or Joe Smith or Gomez or Goldstein or Wong or whatever needn't really look back to British treasure houses that none of them came from. I mean, they should be proud of their tract houses, their station wagons and fast food and Herculean furniture. I mean, their bloody television shows. They are conquering the world. Everybody wants what they want, and not just Germans, Italians, Englishmen. They are even building a Disneyland outside of Paris. I mean, I tell these workaday Yanks that they've got it all and that they are the envy of the world. And do they believe me? No, 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 no. They wait in line for hours to catch a glimpse of Charles and Diana. They collect royal books and paraphernalia. I mean, they even watch Masterpiece Theater. I mean, it ain't all beer and skittles today in the UK, you know? I mean, there's racial unrest and widespread unemployment. I mean, you'd have to be crazy not to be envious of people who live the sedate life in the suburbs, scarfing down all the tofutti you can get down your throat at the local mall. And with all these motor car companies that are willing to shell out millions to put together these exhibits. But when I try to get some of these guineas, what do I end up with? I end up with crazed teenage software millionaires that collect baseball cards. Or dippy socialites that are throwing $1,000 plate dinners to alleviate world hunger. I mean, really, it's enough to drive a person absolutely bats. I really don't know what to do about it. It's driving me nuts, and I mean, I've only been here for a little while. I don't know what I should do if I had to stay in this country one more.
Now, this message has been brought to you by the Mobil Oil Corporation, North Sea Division. How did Marilyn Monroe die? Was it murder, suicide, or an accidental drug overdose? And who was her mysterious final caller who may have driven her over the edge? Recent allegations have implicated certain prominent liberal Democrats in her demise. But the Public Interest Follies have uncovered the real story at last. Marilyn, the true facts.
So there I was, stretched out on the bed after the amputation. And I wake up and say, where's the rest of me? Get it? Where's the rest of me?
Yes, Ryan. Good night.
But wait, you haven't heard the one about the Chicago welfare queen. It turns out the dame was collecting so many darn welfare checks that she was riding around town in a pink Cadillac convertible. You know? That reminds me of a letter I received some time ago from a young fan. I can't quite remember what the letter said, but I am nonetheless reminded of that very letter. And about those darn Democrats. You know, I used to be one myself till I finally said, I'd rather switch than fight. Those folks have gone so far to the left that they've left everyone behind and fallen right off the edge of the earth, don't you think?
Johnny, you are boring me to death.
Down Route 1 the other day. It was a glorious day. The sun was shining on the side.
Darn! I thought that we would find out the real truth tonight. Gee whiz. I guess we're never going to know what happened to Ronald Reagan out on Route 1.
I'm sure you have all read accounts of the recent U.S. visit of the Bishop Desmond Tutu. But the State Department is very concerned that Americans have only been presented with one view of a highly complicated situation. Therefore, the U.S. has set up a new public relations bureau to educate Americans of the real story. Their first U.S. guest are a dynamic delegation from Pretoria who have taken time from their busy schedule to be with us here tonight. So now, ladies and gentlemen, direct to you out of South Africa, Bwana Ross and the Supremacists.
Choice but to ban the press. They ruined our PR in the U.S.
But we trust some of you. The boys at Dartmouth know what we've been through.
If you don't buy our party line,
think of our diamond mines. Think it over.
We've given jobs to them.
Think it over.
We've been so sweet to them.
Fighting apartheid, don't you know to lie? Think it over.
Past laws are for their good.
Think it over.
We've been so misunderstood.
Sanctions are a Marxist plot. Commies taking what we colonists got.
You don't want us to end up like Zimbabwe. What about our country clubs and croquet?
If you want to end unrest, trust us and don't divest. Think it over.
Good to you.
Think it over.
Haven't we been sweet to you?
Stop fighting apartheid. Afrikaners are satisfied. God is on our side. Who cares how many have died? Think it over.
We've given jobs to them.
Think it over.
Sweet to them.
Think it over.
Haven't we been good to you?
Think it over.
Haven't we been sweet to you?
Think it over.
It's said there are seven deadly sins, but today avarice, oh, avarice is by far the most popular. To handle the throngs flocking to this most seductive of sins, the devil has hired an assistant, and a most glamorous one at that. Now, here she is with some free tax advice to prove you don't really need a tax analyst. Tonight, we meet Deductress.
Thank you.
Gail gave it to me, the deductress. I'm just collecting the neatest artifacts since I came back here. You just wouldn't believe it. Like, look at this. A Metro fare card? It didn't work. And this. A 10,044? I don't know how you guys understand this stuff. Wait. And I got onion rings from the trio, and I even got to see part of a made-for-TV movie. It was fantastic. Wait till you see it.
The Mitch Snyder Story. Tonight's made-for-television motion picture starring Martin Sheen will continue in a moment. But now, a word from our sponsor.
Reagan Regan Realty really cares about the homeless.
So we're offering you the chance of a lifetime.
You can get in on the ground floor of the biggest deal in town.
New condominium grates.
Complete with rust-free steel grid pattern parquet floor.
Close to the bus stop.
In fact, it is the bus stop.
There may not be molding.
But there's plenty of mold.
Utilities included.
Passive solar in the summer.
Forced air all winter. And the mortgage is adjustable.
Based on what you can panhandle in a week.
So call today and make an offer on this great property.
Remember, there's a line of people hungry for these deals.
Act now and get your very own Lafayette Square.
Hey. And if you come see us this weekend, we'll throw in free daily garbage delivery at no extra charge.
So telephone 22-GRATE for a no-strings walkthrough of our greats. You'll be glad you did.
Saturday night used to find most gay men in the bars and discos, but today things are different. Why? Because Saturday night is when National Public Radio broadcast its new hit program, A Fairy Home Companion. And now, ladies and gentlemen, let's visit a rehearsal. And here's your host, that fabled star of the silver screen, Miss Ruby Keeler.
Gather round, kids. It's time for another edition of A Fairy Home Companion, the program that comes to you direct from San Francisco, a gay community that's real, but you really shouldn't go there. A town where all the men are strong, the women good-looking, and the children nowhere to be seen. The program is brought to you by products you really shouldn't buy anymore. And here to join us in the fun is the Nelly Thompson Trio!
I'm a toy balloon that is fated soon to pop. But if baby, I'm the bottom, you're the top. You're the top.
Hey, Ruby, this guy is Spike Repressed from the National Medical Emergency Strike Force, and he's got this warrant that lets him censor our material.
Gee, Willikers, what does that mean?
Well, he says it's his business to ensure that nothing we broadcast violates the safe sex guidelines.
Cricket, Spike! How could a program of old Broadway show tunes violate the safe sex guidelines?
Why, you dirty rat! Don't you know that filth is seeping into American culture, spreading disease and perversion, poisoning the minds of innocent children? Especially the dirty lyrics of these raunchy rock songs!
But we don't perform rock songs! Come on, Spike, don't be silly!
Listen, sister, don't give me none of your lip! I've heard about you and your lewd, suggestive rap dances.
I don't do rap dances. I tap dance.
Your little gal, your cup of celery, your cellophane. It's a lie.
Jeepers, creepers, this is the first time I ever tangled with the censors. Why, I was the most wholesome star in Hollywood.
I'm a toy balloon.
This is the filthiest song I ever heard. Censored, censored, censored.
Golly
gosh. But we've got another opening number ready to go. Kids, let's do the other one.
Anyway, Ozzy Osbourne?
Oh, no, Spike. Why, I believe that's Cole Porter.
Cole Porter? That faggot. We don't want no faggot stuff thrown over the air. Understand?
Holy moly. I guess we'll have to cut it out. Hey, I know a song you can't possibly object to. And I did it on Broadway, and it was a big hit, too. Hit it!
Disgusting and dangerous.
Holy cow, but why?
The lyrics don't make it clear that these jerks should be drinking out of separate cups. Who's serving this tea anyway? Some faggot waiter, I suppose. Oh, I can see the whole thing now. Crisp white linens, fresh flowers, candles on the table. And in the background, some violinist playing sticky sweet music. You got one song that's clean and decent.
I'll go my way by myself. This is the end of romance. I'll go my way by myself.
Ever seen this before? Did all this stuff really happen? Listen to this. Madonna, Sean, and Barbara Bush in Tori's Love Triangle. Oh, wait a minute. Imelda to Ferdinand, stay away from Corey, she's no good. Bugs Bunny finds out real truth when he asked Don King and Tina Turner, who undoes your hair? Next year on Dynasty, there will only be one Crystal Carrington. But there's going to be two of every other character? This is going to make great stuff for my thesis. I can't wait to go backstage and finish reading it. But before I go, I have to introduce our grand kabuki number. Now, this next number is called Graham Kabuki Rudman. It's sort of an East meets West kind of number. Now, it says here in the book by Professor Grumbacher that this act had so many props that it took a full 4 minutes to set up behind the curtain. And this was considered rather tedious by some members of the audience who sat around and said things like, this really makes them look like amateurs. And, what is this? Some group of people that only get together once a year. Now, the professor did a detailed analysis of the kabuki number, and she says right here that apparently the number grows out of the efforts of the bad experimental dance theater to finally find a niche sufficiently avant-garde, as she says here, for their heretofore undiscovered talents. Now, some of you might remember last year that great number, How a Bill Becomes a Law. Well, whenever the nation's trade deficit got larger than $100 billion with Japan, some of us kind of got a yen, RRR, for things that were kind of Japanese. The rest, they say, you know, is history. At least to me, it is anyway. So sit back, relax, and think good liberal thoughts, and I'm going to go back here and see if they're done with the pagodas, okay? Stay with us.
The Bad Experimental Dance Theater, renowned for its use of dancers who are neither trained nor talented, makes its first foray tonight into non-Western theatrical tradition with its groundbreaking production, Gram Kabuki Rodman. This work marks the first use of classical Japanese kabuki theater to illuminate legislative history, and is especially noteworthy because neither its authors nor producers have actually seen a real kabuki production. And now, Gram Kabuki Rodman.
Once upon a time, there was a city upon the hill, overlooking a vast and prosperous domain. Its rulers thought themselves wise and just.
We are great and good!
But all was not well in this land of tea and sushi. For an ominous darkness was falling across the land and growing larger each day, a shadow cast by the huge, horrible deficit beast.
Deficit beast!
It had to be stopped before it ate everything in the land.
Deficit beast!
Make him stop!
You stop him!
No, you!
No, you stop him!
No! We must never increase taxes!
Never!
Never!
And so the deficit beast rears its ugly head. Enough to act until
the beast is hungry.
Something had to be done. The rulers asked for intervention from higher powers, higher even than themselves. No reply from on high. In desperation, they called on a fierce mercenary warrior, Samurai Gram Rodman, known for his deadly swordsmanship and his acid indigestion. The rulers were so relieved. They didn't ask Samurai Gram Rodman his plan, but even if they had, they wouldn't have cared.
Slash away, Gram Rodman! Slash away, warrior man!
You great big guy!
The samurai could do what the rulers could not, slay the deficit beast.
Yo!
But the deficit beast cannot be killed with a few slashes of even this samurai's sword. Samurai rethinks his strategy and then strikes at the most vulnerable parts of the beast, the heart, the soul, and the conscience.
School lunch, pension, student.
The samurai has tasted blood and only thirsts for more. He spies the once untouchable arms of the obese.
Pentagorgon, sacred dragon! Pentagorgon, sacred dragon!
Yo! Oh, yo!
Pentagorgon, the insatiable military spending dragon, which has become stronger as the deficit obese has grown. Manages to slash away some of the waste. And so the Pentagorgon raged on. Had created lay in ruins. Yet the deficit obese still terrorized the land. The people began to lose faith in their rulers, and Samurai Graham Rudman, the warrior who was to have saved the land, turned out to be nothing but government by Vegomatic. There was only one alternative.
What? Samurai Graham Rudman must go!
The people turned their backs on the samurai in anger.
Bring back Amtrak!
Restore public housing!
Restore job corps and student loans!
Stop Graham Rudman!
Samurai has lost honor. But the final blow was losing his table at the palm. And so,
humiliation!
The dejected warrior performs a ritual harakiri.
Huh?
Harry Carey? Graham Rudman was no more, but the deficit obese remained. The rulers had failed. They lost honor, votes, and worse yet, PAC contributions. In their place, the people put new rulers who vowed to get rid of the deficit obese quickly and justly.
Tame the Pentagorgon!
Restore social programs!
Close tax loopholes!
They condemned the deficit obese to Weight Watchers and put him on a jogging program.
Run, beast!
And so the people of the land rejoice.
Oh,
tonight has just been so great. I'm so glad that you all let me share it with you. There's so much that I've done and that I've seen. You know, I had a chance to meet the people here at the Follies. I got to meet Byron and them. I got to take my first subway ride. I got to watch TV. You know, it's been so great. There's no way that my thesis isn't going to be the best one in the class. But before I go, I think there's something that I should read to you from Dr. Brumbacher's book. I want to read you a little passage. He says, those uniting for social change in the 1980s could have had no way to know how their efforts changed history. Many suffered from what was then called burnout. And they became discouraged about the usefulness of their work, particularly in the light of the conservative renaissance. Now, I hope that that's not true for any of you here. I just wish that I could tell you all what really happens. Mr. Kennard! Oh, Mr. Kennard, where are you? Mr. Kennard, I have to go back. Mr. Kennard.
Yeah?
Thanks again for letting me attend, but I've got to get back to my own time, so I'm afraid that I'm going to have to leave.
Oh, you can't stay for the close?
No, I've got an appointment with my shrink, and I'm late already. But before I go, I think there's something that I should let all of you know, and that's that the people in my time are really grateful to the people in yours. Sir, thanks again for saving the world.
You're welcome.
So long.
Hey, wait. Before you go, can't you just tell me one little thing about how we get this glorious liberal revolution off the ground?
Well, you know I'm not allowed to say a word about that. And besides, I've given away too much tonight already. But I guess I can give you one hint.
Yeah, one hint, please.
But it's something that you already know.
Yeah.
Now, here's the key. Hang in there, baby.
Hang in there, baby. That's all you can tell me?
Uh-huh.
Listen, I've been hanging in there for a long time already. I started working for liberal causes back in 1952 when Adlai Stevenson ran for president. I was a little kid.
Then I think that you should know something about endurance and survival. That's gonna come in handy. Sir, so long. See you in 30 years.
Good times and long times, I've seen them all, and no fear, I'm still here. Nice office sometimes, sometimes eviction is near, but I'm here. I work for Adlai. As a tyke, I loved him madly. They liked Ike. 52 wasn't my year, but I'm here. I marched through Selma. I wept at Newark and Watts, but I'm here. Would overwhelm a dream of a new Camelot, but I'm here. Stood by the Great Society, fought in the war on poverty. You can't make a ban on DDT a career. Away. McGovern appeared quite sincere, so I'm here. I've gotten through LBJ in the Rose Garden, watching his bombers take wing. I've gotten through Nixon and Gerry Ford's pardon. Frankly, I thought he should swing. I was at Stonewall, the NYPD was the host, and I'm here. Made my one phone call, rang up the Washington Post, and I'm here. Been called a pinko, commie tool. I used to think, oh, what a fool. I should have gone to a business school, that seems clear. Still, someone said volunteer, so I'm here. I've been through Carter, Mondale, and then Gary Hart. And I'm here. Felt like a martyr, taking the Democrats' part. But I'm here. Protested war in Vietnam. Marches galore with Pelequam. I fought so the atmosphere wouldn't disappear. I read Ferraro's memoirs, and I'm here. I've gotten through Ron and Don, Regan or Reagan. Boy, this is fun and a half. If I get through Don and Ron, Regan or Reagan, anything else is a laugh. Good times and bum times, I've seen them all, and my dear, I'm still here. Seats up front sometimes, sometimes you sit in the rear, but I'm here. If you declare that change must start, you're just another bleeding heart. I got through all of last year, and I'm here. Lord knows at least I've been there, and I'm here. Look who's here. I'm still here. I'm still here, but I'm not here.